atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
Roger. Ready to move out.
You ever dance with the devil and pay him in mind?
This town needs an enema.
Riddle me this. Riddle me that. Who's afraid of the big black bat?
When Gotham ashes, you have my permission to die.
Gotham! This is your liberation.
My mother warned me about getting into cars with strange men.
This isn't a car.
20 years in Gotham, how many good guys are left? How many stayed that way? He has the power to wipe out the entire human race.
Tell me, do you bleed? You will.
I want you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
He's a silent guardian. A watchful protector. Dark Knight.
I'm Batman.
Let the games begin.
Welcome to the Batman on Film Podcast. Here are your hosts, Bill Jett Ramey and Rick Hsu.
Hey now, welcome and thanks for listening to the Batman on Film Podcast. BOF is the sponsor and also a member of the Batman Podcast Network. Check us out at batmanpodcastnetwork.com. On Volume 2, Episode 47 of the Batman on Film Podcast, I'm joined by co-host Rick Hsu and Ryan Haas, as well as our very special guest, Neil Turitz from The Tracking Board. Now, on with the show. Well, we're back with another Batman on Film podcast. With me today are my co-hosts, Ryan Haas and Rick Hsu. How you two guys doing this morning?
Fantastic. That's my post-surgery fantastic.
I'm about to say, you had back surgery earlier this week. What was that? What was worse, that or the election?
I don't want to talk about the election. Okay. But let me just say this. I feel like this is like the 900th podcast I've done on Vicodin, and so I feel really strange that sounds like that's a common theme. This has all been related to my back, the cortisone shots and everything. Just so everybody knows, I'm a trooper, not a pill popper.
I'm glad.
No, I'm recovering. Emotionally and psychologically from the election. No, not really. excited about our guest today, and excited to talk about the DCEU.
Yes. Ryan, how are you, sir?
I'm good. Speaking of the election, I was just going to say that I can't wait to talk about something less divisive, like the DCEU. So.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think Zack Snyder should get rid of the Electoral College.
All right, let's bring on our guest. We have the columnist from the Tracking Board, Neil Turitz, here. How you doing, Neil?
Hey guys, nice to be here. Well, thanks for having me.
Yes, great to have you on. I read your article that you wrote for the Tracking Board, The Complicated Case of Leadership and Vision at Warner Brothers and DC Entertainment, and I thought it was fascinating. Well done, sir.
Thank you.
And I had to get you on. I told these guys I got to get Neil on, who wrote that article. So tell us a little bit about yourself, what you do, and we know you write for the Tracking Board and so forth, but whatever else you may be interested in discussing or plugging real quick.
Well, I'm a filmmaker first, but I've been a journalist and a filmmaker for a long time. I've been working in and writing about Hollywood for about the last 20 years, okay. Mostly in the indie film world, but have some things in development on the studio level now. And in the meantime, I just like writing about, I kind of have a unique perspective because I'm able to kind of work in the industry but also comment on it, and people seem to take what I say seriously, which actually works, sometimes to my detriment. I don't know if you guys saw some of the reaction to that Warner piece that I wrote that drew your attention.
Not only did we see it, we get it even on our end as well.
Yeah, I find it fascinating because my boss, the guy who runs the site, said to me after I'd been working for him, I started working for the site in March, so I've been there for about 8 months. And one of the first things he said to me was, "You can't get enough hate mail to satisfy me." And I said, "Great, we're going to get along really well then." And I thought that, you know, the more angry responses I get, the happier it makes me. Because, you know, I mean, my thing is you can get as insulting as you want with me. My response is always going to be the same. Thanks for reading.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah, we're considered by many to be haters of the DCEU, and that is not the case. Just because we criticize and try to lobby and demand better films from Warner Brothers with their DCEU endeavors. So, listen, let me ask you. Then I'll start with this: what the hell is going on with the DCEU and Warner Brothers right now?
Well, the big thing is that they are making so much money that they don't necessarily care about how they're viewed. That's one of the things I talked about. That's the thing that I wrote that got your attention. I think that I know somebody. I wouldn't say I'm friends with him, but I know a guy who works at Warner and is very familiar with the DCEU. And he's not a comic book guy. He's not a superhero guy. He doesn't really care about that stuff. But he is familiar with the world and works within the framework of that, so he has a lot of contact with it. And I asked him about Famuyiwa?
Yes.
Yes.
Famuyiwa, when he left, I said, what the hell's going on over there, guys? I mean, are you guys freaked out there or what? And he said, you know what? There's a meeting tomorrow, and if it comes up even once, then I'll know. And we spoke the next day, and he said, they couldn't care less. All we talked about in the meeting was how much money they made on Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
Which I think we can all agree was dreck.
Yes. I did. Say this. I saw it, and I went to the junket in New York. I saw it. I didn't hate it. I thought the thing that saved it was the cast had quite a bit of chemistry, and I thought that was what, to me, made the film somewhat enjoyable, but it's not something that I'm chomping at the bit to see again, like the Nolan films, which I'll watch at any time.
Bill, you also, with each viewing, you started to like it less, and that's always a bad thing.
Yes, I did say
that. There's not as much substance when the only thing you focus on are the characters. The thing I want to point out is the fact that Suicide Squad just ended its theatrical run, and it ended with only 5 million short of BVS's, the domestic tally. So I kind of wonder, does that mean, what do you guys think about that? Does that mean that Suicide Squad is overperformed and BVS is underperformed based on how big, quote, big each movie was supposed to be and which kind of characters were in it? You know, wouldn't you assume that the movie with Batman and Superman headlining it should have done them better compared to Suicide Squad?
What do you think, Neil?
I think that Suicide Squad performed exactly the way that they thought it was going to. I think that it didn't overperform. I mean, it did just shy of $750 million worldwide. And I think that Batman Superman, they were expecting that to clear a billion. I mean, did what? It was 862. Is that the final number?
Something close in there. Yeah.
Very close.
And I think that, you know, that I wrote once earlier this year, I said that it's the highest grossing disappointment in history. Because most movies, if it came in with that kind of gross, they'd be doing cartwheels. But this was something where it led to panic. I mean, they were, you know, 873. Thank you. It led to panic. I mean, they had all these moves that they made after the fact. And, that kind of has led them to where they are now.
Well, and on that note, Ryan, Neil, if you don't mind me asking, so you alluded earlier that they're celebrating because of the money that they're making, so they just simply don't care. Yet, and at the same time, they made a lot of changes that we can get into later that you referenced in your article. So I'm just trying to figure out what that disconnect is.
I mean, I think this is the way it works. When I say they don't care about perception of things like The Flash. They understand that Wonder Woman and Justice League have to work or else. The Flash is lower priority for them. Flash is lower priority for them. I listened to your guys' podcast last week, the emergency one you did, and there were a couple interesting things that you guys talked about that I kind of want to address. I don't have confirmation on this, but I have things that this is my instinct on what's going to happen, and I have gotten some tacit kind of, that kind of sounds about right from my Warner guy. Wonder Woman, he said, look, it's okay to be excited about Wonder Woman, that Patty Jenkins kind of got it right, and that Gal Gadot is terrific. Justice League, they're very excited about how it looks because, again, the fact that they kind of came in and they did a course correction on it, they feel like it's really something that's, it's what they had intended to be. And that Zack Snyder is on a leash now. Mm-hmm. So there's that. I think that it's safe to say Flash is going to get bumped. I think that they're going to move Aquaman up from July to March and take that spot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's interesting. Is that a gut feeling, or do you have any insight on that?
Well, again, that's one of those things where that's not confirmation as much as it was kind of a wink and a, that's not a bad idea.
Gotcha. Yeah, gotcha.
No, it's not. Yeah.
So no, it's, yeah, I agree with you 100%.
And the thing is, it's going in front of cameras. Principal photography starts in January. So there's no way it won't be ready in 14 months.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that seems to me to be the perfect way solution to that. You bump Flash back. And also, here's the other thing. They're really excited about Jason Momoa. They love him there.
Yeah.
And I think that they're going to use Justice League as a springboard, and then 4 months later you have the Aquaman movie coming out, and it's mm-hmm. a natural progression. Now, the thing that came out this week is Paramount announced that Mission Impossible 6 is going to come out the same day that Aquaman was originally scheduled for in July of 18. Now, one of two things is going to happen there. Either Warner's going to back off like they did with Batman Superman against Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to blink, or they're going to put Ben Affleck's Batman movie there.
Interesting. We discussed that ourselves. Yep.
I think that's where that movie goes. And if it doesn't, if they back off it, then that movie comes out in October of 18.
Either way,
and the other thing too is that the Bret Easton Ellis thing about the Batman movie being in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
I don't buy it. I don't buy it for the same reason you guys didn't buy it. And my Warner person said, I checked in with him this week, and he said, Ben Affleck is the most anal filmmaker I've ever seen, and I've been working
for years. Wow.
And
there's
no way. And he said, I've seen George Miller come through here. I've seen Chris Nolan come through here. All these guys who work here at Warner, nobody is more anal than Ben Affleck.
More anal than Chris Nolan. That's amazing.
That's something.
Yeah.
It is. And, you know, Neil, what I've been saying, and let me get your thoughts on this, and this is just – like from Rick Shue's ass, right? There's no, this is just, I'm just thought of this.
Well, then I'm really glad you're not on camera here.
It is not a pleasant ass. So yes, I'm glad I'm not on camera either. But I have said for a long time now that what my fear is that they know that Warner Brothers knows that their cash cow is Batman. They also know they have an A-list actor director who, like you just said, is an anal director, who takes his craft very seriously. I'm a huge fan of him, especially directorially. What I've been afraid of, if more of these films come out prior to the Batman, or whatever it may ultimately be called, goes into pre-production, that could be the one thing that sort of breaks the camel's back that could lead to that project being canceled. In other words, if The Flash comes out, or if Justice League comes out and it just doesn't work, Wonder Woman actually kind of falls on its face. And then what? And then Aquaman gets postponed. The Flash gets postponed. Maybe Aquaman does come out, and it's not very well received. At that juncture, if Batman's not already in production, I think that could be something that I would fear that would cease that project. Affleck walks away, and then we're in limbo for God knows how long.
Okay. So here's why I disagree.
Well, no, So let me just give me your thoughts on that.
Here's why I disagree. Batman is bigger than anybody. Is bigger than Superman, is bigger than Wolverine, is bigger than Spider-Man. Yeah. Batman is the cash cow, is the gift that keeps on giving to Warner Brothers.
But even in the confines of that universe?
Even in the confines of that universe,
okay.
Batman will always succeed. And the thing is that people, if they loved anything about Batman, Superman, they loved Ben Affleck as Batman.
Mm-hmm.
This is true.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the thing. After that, and I don't know exact numbers here, but I do know the gist of this. I also want to make it clear, I'm not a reporter. I'm not like Jeff Snyder at Mashable, who is a legitimate breaker of news. Mm-hmm. I'm just a guy who sometimes people talk to, and I tend to write about the news rather than break the news.
Mm-hmm.
But I just kind of got lucky here, and also I'm as fascinated by this world as you guys are, so I did a little more digging, and I happen to know somebody at Warner, so it worked out.
Mm-hmm.
Having said that, after Batman Superman, and they realized, wow, Affleck is really good in this, they went to Ben Affleck and said, okay, what's it going to cost for you to write, direct, and star in a Batman solo movie? And I don't know what the number is. I joked that he probably looked at them and said, for all three of those things, $50 million. And they said, okay, we're just glad you didn't say 100. I mean, I don't know what that number is, but they're paying him so much money to do this. that I don't care how badly all these other films may stumble, Ben Affleck is making that movie.
Yeah.
Well, and you're probably right. My fear wasn't so much about Warner Brothers pulling the plug. It was more about Affleck as an artiste walking away from a kind of a busted.
Well, here's the other thing. He's doing Live by Night because he wanted to do a period gangster pick. He's won his Oscars. He's won two Oscars. He hasn't won for directing, but he won for Best Picture, and he won for writing the first thing he did with Matt Damon 20 years ago. He's won his Oscars. He's making a fortune doing what he loves. Now it's about challenges. I mean, I've had this conversation before. In my opinion, the single greatest superhero movie ever made is The Incredibles. After that, I go with Winter Soldier. I'm not a big Nolan fan. I have a lot of problems with his Batman movies. I think that there are moments of brilliance in them, and I think that Dark Knight is two-thirds of a great movie. I think it's way too long, and I think that the Two-Face edition hurts it. I think that the Batman Joker stuff is a masterpiece, but if you bring Aaron Eckhart back as the villain for number three, that's more effective to me. But that's a different conversation. Mm-hmm. But I think that Ben Affleck, with his skill as a director, can create a movie that is up there with Spider-Man 2, the first two X-Men movies, the first two Chris Reeve Superman films, like the greatest, the ones that we talk about is the great. And a lot of people think The Dark Knight is up there. I don't, but that's fine. You know, that's just my opinion. Mm-hmm. That a lot of people, you know, and look at as, okay, this is one of the shining examples of the genre. And I think that that's a challenge you won't back down from. I also think James Wan is going to deliver with Aquaman. I think James Wan is the one guy they couldn't have afforded to lose, and because he brings something that nobody else does. No offense to Seth Graham Smith, who directed before, or Rick Famuyiwa, who is a very talented guy, but they're not James Wan.
Your article, you said it best in your article. There's a gravitas that he brings.
Right.
And not to get off topic, obviously – the panel here, particularly me, have respectfully disagree with you about the Dark Knight trilogy, but that's cool. I respect your opinion on it.
Listen, I mean,
but I am just curious, and this is just
a lot of people disagree with me.
And this is actually genuinely curiosity. What is your to date definitive Batman film? Do you have one?
Boy, that's a really good question. I don't think that there is one yet.
Fair enough.
Not for me.
Fair enough.
I think that there are moments, there are parts of things that are great. But I don't think that.
If you're sitting on your couch and on HBO, Tim Burton's 1989 Batman comes on and Chris Nolan's Batman Begins comes on simultaneously, which one do you watch?
What else is on?
That's it. The world ends if you don't watch one of them.
Speaking of Nolan,
I watch Batman Begins. I watch Batman Begins over the original.
Cool. I was just curious. Awesome. Yes.
Speaking of Nolan, I wanted to ask you, Neil, and I am, just for disclosure, I am a huge fan of the Dark Knight trilogy as well. But Chris's recommendation to Warner Brothers at one point when he was, producing Man of Steel and finishing up Dark Knight Rises was that he believed that the DC films at Warner should be their own, exist within their own universe. And, obviously Warner Brothers did not take his advice and turned the Man of Steel sequel into a launching pad for a shared universe. Do you agree or disagree with Chris's take or suggestion or opinion on the cinematic world of DC? And I think I think that his main reason is not just the history of DC being much different than Marvel, but the fact that he always felt like filmmakers would be handcuffed or stifled if they were having to take part in a shared universe. Any thoughts on that?
Well, not being a part of a shared universe didn't do a whole lot for Green Lantern. Mm-hmm. I think that I don't agree with that. I think that part of the fun of reading comic books is that sometimes Superman shows up in a Batman story and sometimes Aquaman shows up in a Wonder Woman story or whatever. Mm-hmm. And it was not designed that way. But you know what? There was the Justice Society of America in the 1940s, mm-hmm. Where you brought all these people together and you have, you had crossovers, you had team ups. I think that, and if you have a world where superheroes exist, why not why not expand that world into something where they can exist together? I understand Nolan's perspective, but Nolan, you know, Nolan was given after Batman Begins succeeded, and sadly Heath Ledger died. And I mean, I think that Dark Knight is, again, Dark Knight is a good movie. I'm not saying it's not. I don't love it as much as a lot of people like, and I don't love it as much as you do. I have flaws, I have issues with it, but I think that part of the reason that movie did as much business as it did is because Heath Ledger died. I think if he survived, there's not as much curiosity and fascination. I don't know if it take, does the same. I think it's still a huge success. I don't think it's $1 billion, quite frankly.
Absolutely.
Well, from a filmmaking point of view, I kind of wonder. It seems like they've just had so many growing pains with trying to force all this stuff into a connected universe. And I'm like, after the Dark Knight trilogy, the two examples I'm thinking of, Warner Brothers using that kind of model, is The Hobbit and Harry Potter. You know, those are both gigantic juggernaut franchises. And you know, now the Fantastic Beasts Wizarding World series, that's going to be 5 films, all directed by the same director and all written by J.K. Rowling. And, you know, those are similar in so much as that they're both connected universes, but they're only one film at a time with the same director and, you know, one thing at a time. So essentially, that's the Dark Knight model. So I'm just seeing a difference between them.
But Mission Impossible works, and there's been a different director every time. I mean, take away the John Woo movie, and that success rate is pretty good. It's the last two are terrific.
But it's one. But it's also one series, one movie.
Yeah, so is Harry Potter. So is Harry Potter. Fantastic Beasts is just a prequel. It's the same characters. I mean,
Exactly. And I'm comparing it to the DCEU, where they've got to have it's not one film in one series at a time. It's Wonder Woman. It's Aquaman.
I got you. I misunderstood. I got you. I understand what you're saying. Yeah. I mean, to me, to me, I feel like, you know, if you have Nolan was very specific in what he wanted to do, and other heroes he didn't have any use for other heroes in what he was doing. So if you decide, okay, well, we're going to subscribe to the DC multiverse concept, and we're going to say that that's why we have, and that's the other thing about The Flash not being a high priority on the film side, is because it's a monster hit on television. And, you know, I was always confused about that, why they decided, okay, you don't want to use Grant Gustin, that's fine, but why you would want to rush a Flash into production on the film side when it's doing so well on the small screen. That never quite made a whole lot of sense to me. But let's take this from a macro perspective. If you look at it, and let's really geek out about it. If you look at this as everything that the cinema has done, everything that television has done, is part of this multiverse in the DC world, you could make the argument that Tim Burton's Batman is one world, and Chris Nolan's Batman is another world, and Gotham on TV is another world, and now Ben Affleck is another world. All of these are different universes within the same framework of the DCEU. It's just a question of which continuity you're focusing on at a specific time.
Yeah, I could buy into that, certainly, yes.
That's mostly my theory.
Yeah.
Like, I've talked about it here and there.
Well, that's how I kind of look at it anyway. I mean, I think...
Isn't that a fascinating thing to try to explain to a layman that by the way, is 90% of the people that go to see these films, because geeks like us, we're really the minority in a minority in a minority.
Sure, of course.
You know, because if it was us that would carry these films, they would gross about $100,000. But... when you have, you know, I have friends, when Batman versus Superman came out, they're like, so Christian Bale's not Batman, so why, you know, what's going on with this now? Is it like, Rachel Dolezal going to be in this? I'm like, no, I doubt it. But anyway, this is a different universe, and they just don't get it, particularly in this world of reboots when this stuff is happening constantly. And I think the most complicated thing from a Batman perspective to try to explain, and I think we've struggled with it on our own site, is the films between Batman and Batman and Robin, that's the most fascinating transition, whereas it's the same universe per se, but because a lot of the same crossover actors and there were some references, but once Joel Schumacher took over and Val Kilmer came in, you guys see what I'm saying? Trying to bridge that Batman Returns and Batman Forever.
Right.
Yeah.
But now, and Neil, I've referenced this a few times, 100 years ago, and I'll make this real brief, I was Superman in a stunt show at Six Flags. I could not do a meet and greet with the kids after the show because Dean Cain was playing Superman on TV, right, and they didn't want a conflict of interest. And you think about that now, it's crazy to me. You have now Superman's on Supergirl. Superman exists in this Zack Snyder universe. You have Gotham.
Can we not? Oh, let's not call it the Zack Snyder universe, please.
Well, I don't want to call it that, but today that's what it is. Well, three that films in, it's, you know,
Rick,
no, I guess
Rick, Suicide Squad. Tell Neil your theory, which it's actually, I believe it's fact now, but when we started talking about Justice League and Zack Snyder,
it was the first thing he said.
Yeah, yeah. That when Zack Snyder, it was evident that he was having the reins pulled back on him. You said Justice League was directed by whom?
Oh, I just said, I said that Justice League was now being directed by Zach Affleck.
No, I think that's true.
Yeah,
because Neil almost referenced something like that in his article.
I said something like that. He's sort of director in name only, which I pull back on that a bit. I think he's still the director. I think what Neil referenced in his article, where and we've all alluded to, he's just a little bit on the sidelines where people are watching him, and he's got a little bit of a short leash on him. And I don't mean to put words in people's mouths. This is just sort of our general opinion on this. But this leads to a question that I have, kind of a unnatural/natural segue. If let's say that Justice League works, okay. Well, Neil, let me ask you this before I even say that: do you think that Zack Snyder has a future in the DCEU after Justice League?
No.
Okay. What if it's a home run, and it's just, I mean, it's the biggest film that they've done to date.
Okay.
From a critical standpoints. Box office, everything.
My unvarnished, uneducated, this purely comes from opinion, not from anybody telling me anything. If it goes bad, he's going to get blamed. If it goes well, Affleck's going to get more of the credit than Snyder will.
I think that's perfectly stated.
Yeah.
Because Snyder on his own gave us Man of Steel, which is terrible, and gave us Batman Superman, which is terrible, and I'm going to get disagreement here from you guys too, I'm sure, but I don't believe he's made a good movie since Dawn of the Dead. I think the 300 has some interesting stuff in it, but is ultimately a silly popcorn movie with some great effects. I hated Watchmen. Sucker Punch is god-awful, unwatchable. And then Man of Steel made me actually physically, viscerally angry when I walked out of the theater.
The first time I saw Man of Steel, I felt the same way. I was actually nauseous when I walked out.
Yeah. I walked out.
That third act. Yeah,
it did. But it did. The third act just killed it. But then when I went back to see it, I started to appreciate more of and you know, I might get sucker punched, no pun intended, for saying this, but there were actually a lot of nuanced, great scenes that I get reminded of between a young Clark and his dad and et cetera. But at the same time, it was flawed. And what all the things that I had a problem with in the last chapter, I thought, okay, cool, this is going to get retroactively corrected in BVS. And to an extent it did. But then it also was one of those things in BVS, you're going, was this always the plan, or is this shoehorned in there as some sort of way to try to make that better? And then ultimately just had a lot of things with the Doomsday debacle that was actually even worse than the last chapter of Man of Steel. So it was all very counterproductive.
I think that it was a lot of it was shoehorned. They realized that they'd screwed up and they wanted to go back and try to fix it retroactively. I think that Zack Snyder, when left to his own devices, does not make good movies. He makes great trailers. Mm. Every movie he's ever made has a spectacular trailer, but he can't turn it into a 2 or 2.5 or whatever hour long movie.
Or 3.
It makes any sense.
So just as a frame of reference, I personally like Watchmen. Did you like the graphic novel and hated the film, or just not a fan of it at all? I'm just curious.
Who's not a fan of the graphic novel?
Well, fair enough. My friend Brandon's not.
Look, I think that the Holy Trinity, when it comes to comic books of the modern era since 1980, say, the Holy Trinity to me is Watchmen, Dark Knight, and Year One.
I think Zack Snyder would agree with you.
Those are my favorite. I mean, there's some spectacular stuff you can throw in there around that. Miller's Daredevil run, early Daredevil run, and the 6 issues that he did with David Mazzucchelli. I would put Planetary up there by Ellis and Cassaday. I would put, I'm trying to think. There's a couple other things that are true favorites of mine. I would put the work of The guy who did, now I'm blanking on his name, Terry Moore. I put a lot of Terry Moore's work up there. But since it's a DC thing, I mean, I think that, you know, the Watchmen, the movie would have been a lot better if it hadn't been, well, there's a lot of ways it could have been better, but to me, it was so slavish in its adaptation that there wasn't any room for anything truly creative and interesting to come out of it. I felt it was rote. I felt it was just kind of dull. And that's what fair. Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons did was so mind blowing and so groundbreaking. And I felt that there was an opportunity to do something that on that level cinematically that Snyder's just not inventive enough to do. I just, mm-hmm. I've heard that Zack Snyder is a perfectly lovely guy and I have nothing against him personally. I just don't think he's a good filmmaker.
Yes, he is.
I don't either. When I ultimately look at his filmography, I have to say love, hate, 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 love, hate, 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 kind of like hate, hate, hate. You know, that's mine. That's my Zack Snyder.
Since we brought up, let me ask this question, because I know Neil and I exchanged a few emails, and we were going to bring in also Fox's X-Men universe as a comparison, and certainly Marvel's cinematic universe. And let me frame it, this question this way. Can Warner Brothers pride themselves on being "quote unquote" a filmmaker-driven studio? Can a shared universe be filmmaker-driven, or does it have to be, I guess, for lack of a better term, producer-driven, like the Marvel universe?
That's a really good question. I think that the answer is yes and no. Mm-hmm. I think that I'm going to equivocate a little bit, because I think that if you have a firm guiding hand at the wheel, if you have Kevin Feige, mm-hmm. a Kevin Feige type who is running the show and saying, this is the overall vision of what we're trying to do. Shane Black said when he did Iron Man 3, he said, it's just a question of who's putting the suit on. He's talking about the Iron Man suit, but he's also talking about directing one of these movies, mm-hmm. that there is a framework in place that you only have a certain amount of leeway to make your movie within the framework of within the confines of what they give you.
It's almost about like being a showrunner on a television
to some
series.
Extent. Well, yeah. Actually, I would say it's more like writing the individual episodes, and Feige is the showrunner.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
I think that you have a certain amount of freedom to write a great episode. You know, people who won Emmys for writing, like, I'm blanking on her name now. Moira Wally-Beckett wrote one of the great hours in the history of television, the third to last episode of Breaking Bad, mm-hmm. and she won an Emmy for it. And I don't know if you guys watched that show.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. Okay, so the third to last episode was the peak of the series. Mm-hmm. It was just, I mean, the finale is great. The whole series is amazing. But that episode was off the charts. Now it's Vin, it's Vince, now I'm losing his name too. The
Gilligan?
Creator. Thank you. Vince Gilligan's show, he's Kevin Feige, but she wins the Emmy for writing this particular episode.
Yeah.
So she gets
that's a great analogy.
That,
yeah.
Baby. And I think the same thing is here. You know, I saw Doctor Strange 3 times this week because I loved it. Mm-hmm. I love Doctor Strange. I thought it was really well done. I know this isn't what we're talking about, but I use it as a frame of reference.
Yeah.
Scott Derrickson came in and you did something really interesting pushing the limits with visuals, with mysticism, with all of this stuff. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie yet, but
I have, yeah.
But to me, it's okay. I'm given these limitations. I'm going to do this within these limitations. So a filmmaker has a certain amount of ability within those confines. And I think that Peyton Reed, to some extent, did it with Ant-Man. And I think the Russo brothers have done it with the last two Captain America movies. But I think that what they don't have at Warner and what they don't have at Fox is that one guiding hand. I think that Johns and Berg at Warner were promoted after BVS. Mm-hmm. And now it's a question of, okay, now what? You know, yeah. I think that Marvel had the luxury. People forget that Iron Man was an enormous risk. In retrospect, it looks like it was a sure thing. It wasn't. Mm-hmm. It was a huge, huge risk. And Iron Man 2 almost killed everything.
Yeah.
Almost killed everything. But they pressed on, and then they came out with Thor. Thor was a big hit. Captain mm-hmm. America was a big hit. Boom, Avengers. Mm-hmm. That's how you do it. Warner tried that with Green Lantern, but it was so bad. They miscalculated on every level. On the writing side, they brought in the wrong director to do it. They had it was just a misfire in every conceivable way, because Green Lantern and Iron Man when that at the time, those were comparative levels.
Yeah, yeah, I know for a fact folks at Warner Brothers told me that Green Lantern was supposed to be their Iron Man. That was what they patterned around. Yes.
Yeah, and the mainstream audience didn't know who either one of them were. Right. You know, right. That's the point of this.
And but that becomes a hit. You build around him, and I think that, you know, if, as I said in the article, as my guy at Warner told me, is that Geoff Johns, I'm also not a big Geoff Johns fan. I think he's just kind of fan fiction, lowest common denominator stuff. And I know that people will absolutely hate on me for that. And that's fine. Bring it. It's opinion. You guys are allowed to have your opinion. And if you love Geoff Johns, God bless. It's all about taste. I don't happen to like his stuff and I don't read it. But I have been told that John Berg is a superstar inside Warner and they really love him there. So he's a guy who has great judgment and he's the one who oversaw Nolan's Dark Knight trilogy, which, as we know, did pretty well.
Yeah.
So did Robin, though.
I'm sorry?
So did Charles Robin, though. And look what happened to him. That's what I was wondering. Like that was one of the guys that kind of was a casualty of yeah, the shift in people.
Yeah, but the difference is that Rovin was Berg was the studio guy, yeah, and Rovin is an independent producer, and independent producers are expendable, and studio guys who do well work within the system.
That makes sense. Yeah.
So if that works, if we see Wonder Woman is successful and Justice League is a good movie, then suddenly they're back on the rails and they have high hopes for Aquaman. And then they have the Batman movie coming out and suddenly all this doomsday talk we've been discussing and you guys have talked about and I've been writing about suddenly seems like a quaint notion that everybody was worried about nothing a couple of years ago.
So, you know? Yeah. So who do you go ahead, Ryan.
So by the time that happens, if Justice League is – Wonder Woman's great, Justice League is – thank God is okay, and then they start doing, you know, Aquaman and Batman, do you think they'll start just doing single-character movies with, you know, other characters thrown in for cameos and kind of move off of this Justice League model, you know? So it's more like just individual films in a shared universe.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the Flash, I think they still have every intention of doing it. They've already spent millions of dollars on the Flash. They're not going to, that movie's not going to go away. You know, that's not how studios work. You you spend money, you keep throwing good money after bad until the movie comes out. Something like that happens. That's what happened with Man of Steel. Man of Steel cost an extra $50 or $100 million because of all the development that had, no, I'm sorry, not Man of Steel. Superman Returns was an extra $75 or $100 million because of all the development that had gone in previous.
You had the Tim Burton. Yeah, the Tim Burton. Yeah, Superman lives.
You know, I mean, that all was, it was all part of one, it was all one big expenditure. I think that, you know, they hired Lord and Miller to do a story outline and maybe direct the film. Mm-hmm. They never actually signed on for the film, but they were going to direct, and then they went off, as you guys talked about last week, they went off to do the Han Solo movie instead. Yeah. That's when they brought in Seth Graham Smith, who is Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, became known as a novelist, got into films, and has become a successful screenwriter, and this was going to be his directorial debut, as you guys have talked about. Mm-hmm. That movie's going to happen. They're not going to just have Ezra Miller around to just show up in Justice League and do cameos. They're going to, you know, that movie is going to happen. It's a question of when. Maybe it's late 2018. Maybe it's not until 2019. But it's on the docket. There's going to be another Green Lantern movie. There's going to be a second Justice League movie. Assuming these next two, Wonder Woman and Justice League, let's assume that they succeed.
Okay.
If that happens, then that's it. Aquaman's going to happen, and it's going to be a hit. Batman, the Ben Affleck movie, is going to be a hit. Then it's – the floodgates are open. You know, and you might, then you could see Dick Grayson show up in this world. Mm-hmm. You could see a big screen Oliver Queen show up in this world. You could see all number of things. I mean, you know, the DC universe, comic book universe, is just as big as the Marvel one.
Mm-hmm. And a lot,
you know, you could see the New Gods and the Omega Men. I mean, you could do a kind of, if they decide they want to do a Guardians of the Galaxy type of thing, send them off into space. You know,
we started with Suicide Squad and kind of started wrapping up here. Suicide Squad was a success box office wise. You see David Ayer returning to that world again after with a Suicide Squad sequel or not?
No, I don't. But I do think that there's going to eventually be a Suicide Squad sequel. And we're forgetting that Margot Robbie is going to do a solo.
Harley Quinn and Birds of Prey. Yeah.
And they're going to do Birds of Prey. So there's that, too. I mean, they're already. There's no end to the DC universe. Mm-hmm. I think that
Yeah, by virtue of the Halloween costume she sold, they're going to do a spin-off.
That's right. Yeah. That's exactly right.
Seriously, I mean, yeah.
And I can't see them bringing in Jared Leto to play Joker, and of course in Suicide Squad, which it turned out was extended cameo, but with him not showing up in a Batman film at some point.
Well, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
That makes perfect sense. Affleck and Leto going head-to-head would be fantastic, especially because Leto was so angry about how much of his stuff was left on the editing room floor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He saw the movie, and he was furious. He came out and said, we've discussed that.
Is that something that you kind of have confirmed on the inside? Because I've heard back and forth on that, no, he wasn't really angry. He was fine. My guess is he had to be because – my gosh, there was. I mean, everybody knows in this industry, and I've been in it myself to a small extent. That you do things, even the films that I've been in. I'm like, man, my best takes have never made the final cut. They've always ended up on the editing floor. That's just part of the gig. But it just seems like 90% of what he shot was gone.
Well, he saw the movie, got pissed, and they were on the press junket, so he had to dial it back and be more of a team player is what it amounted to. But yeah, I'm sure he. I mean, I think it was pretty clear that he was upset with...
I will just say this, and I will leave it to interpretation. Do you really hire Jared Leto to play the Joker for 10 minutes?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Great way to put it.
I mean, answer.
No, you don't. And that leads to another thing, too. Now we're about to get a Suicide Squad extended version on DVD.
Ugh.
And... right, and so this obviously can't be the trajectory of this is getting to a little bit of a beating. Now we're in consecutive films where this is actually how the film was intended to be viewed. That has to change, right? I mean, we can't.
I am so tired of these director's cuts. You know what? Have some balls and put out a 3-hour movie if you think this is so much better. It's a small, cynical money grab. That's all it is. And there are too many people who fall for it and buy the extended version and say, oh, it's so much better. You know what? Can I swear on this thing or no?
Oh, yes.
You know what? Fuck you. It's ridiculous.
Yes.
I mean, that drives me crazy. People said, Jesse Eisenberg's performance as Lex Luthor in BVS makes so much more sense. You know what?
People fight us on that, man.
We were highly critical of the extended cut or whatever in the hell they called it, the BVS extended cut or whatever it was, whatever in the hell it was.
All it did was
tighten up a couple of storylines and already bad,
convoluted
bad
film that it's still
yeah,
convoluted.
And I just didn't prove it for me at all. So
the only thing about the extended version of BVS that I would say was quote unquote better was I personally like Henry Cavill in the role of Superman. I want to see him have a respectable platform. Man of Steel is a mixed bag. I do like it. It's a B minus for me. BVS is a B minus for me. There's a lot of things that I do like so much about those films that make it not be a C or a D, but ultimately they're not great films. They're okay, and what keeps them afloat for me above that C mark is I like the cast. I like a lot of the visuals because that's what Zack Snyder is, and that's what I liked about the extended cut was I like seeing a little bit of that, odd to say, sort of that detective journalist Clark Kent. I liked a little bit of that, but at the same time, was that worth it? What was it? What did I spend on that fucking thing anyway? I mean, it's just, it's silly. I agree with you, Neil. It's silly. It's a money grab.
I think that if you're going to make a 2.5-hour movie, superhero movie, then making a 2-hour and 40 or 2-hour and 45-minute superhero movie is not that much of a difference. I think that Dark Knight Rises made a lot of money and it was just shy of 3 hours long.
Yeah.
I think that if you really want to, if Zack Snyder says, you know, I cut 30 minutes out of this movie and I think that it really hurt it. And I think that, you know, I mean, it's again, if you really believe on the studio level that this is worthwhile, then stand behind it and put the movie out and make it a little bit longer. You're going to get just as many people to sit through it and you're going to get just as money. You're going to make just as much money.
Yeah. They knew, Neil, they knew that they had a mess on their hands, you know, and that was the scuttlebutt before. But when I went to California to see it and attend the junket, that was the first time that I've never was able to bring a plus one, which was my wife. I mean, all the Nolan films, I brought her, she went to the junket with me, and they were just like, you can't bring a plus one, and I had to sign.
You were able to for Man of Steel too, right?
And Man of Steel, yes. And I had to sign a non-disclosure agreement before I saw BVS at the theater, before I walked in and saw it. And I've never experienced that, even with Chris Nolan and how anal he can be. So I knew right then there was something going on. And then the next day, one of my friends there said, well, what did you think? You know, and I went, huh? And they were like, really? And, you know, cause they felt, oh, he's Batman guy. He's going to love this no matter what. And I was like, no, it's not the case this time. I didn't love it no matter what. So.
Hey, Bill, I know that you and Michael Uslan are friends. Were you actually at the junket? Was he with you there at the BBS junket?
No, Michael. No, he wasn't there. No.
He wasn't there. Okay.
No.
I want to clarify something if I could.
Yes.
I wish I'd done this right off the bat for your listeners because I want to make something very clear. I taught myself how to read on Batman comics when I was 4 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I have read comic books my entire life. I'm 45 now. I still read comic books. And what I like to say is when I was a boy, the only two things I cared about were baseball and superheroes. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm an adult, the only things that has changed is I've added women and movies.
Yes.
And so I have a deep and abiding love for the superhero genre, not just comic books, but the movies. And when they're done right, they make me as happy as anything. I want these movies to do well. I want them to succeed. I want to like them. And Batman has always been my favorite. Batman and Robin have always been, later Nightwing, have always been my two favorite characters. So it breaks my heart over and over and over again when these movies don't give me what I want. Now, mm-hmm. do I have high yeah. hopes? Do I have set the bar very high for myself? I do, admittedly. But I can tell you on a different podcast or when we're not on the air or whatever, I can tell you what all my problems are with Nolan's trilogy. And you may not agree with me, but you'll at least say, okay, that makes sense.
No, we'll do a trilogy. We've talked about the films and podcasts before, but we're planning on, we can do a whole trilogy podcast, and I'd love to have a different view on besides.
I will happily come
back. And Neil, if you have it, I want to go back and through archives and read any writings you have on that. And if you would do me a solid, and I wrote an op-ed a couple years ago on BOF, and it was about, if you're a comic book fan, you should love the Nolan trilogy, and here's why. And then I would just love to have a respectful dialogue with you about that. That would be fantastic.
I've written a lot about the Nolan trilogy. If I've written a lot, but I've spoken a lot, and I will absolutely come back, and we can have a good long conversation about what – look, and again, I recognize that they're quality movies. The first two are quality movies. I have a major, major problem. I think Dark Knight Rises is lazy storytelling on a lot of levels, but – I will happily talk at length about my feelings about the trilogy. I think that'd be a lot of fun. But just to finish my point, I want these movies to be great. Mm-hmm. So when they're not, I'm really hard on them because I feel like it's not that difficult to do these things right. Marvel shows us again and again and again, and I unabashedly love the Marvel movies. I'm a DC guy growing up, but I love the Marvel movies mm-hmm. because they have a plan. They're consistent. Like them or don't, they are consistent.
They absolutely
know that you're
are.
Going to get something very specific every time you sit in one of those movies. And what DC and Warner need to do is find that level of consistency. Like it or don't, at least give us something that we know we can get every time. And they have not done that through the 27 years since Batman. You know,
mm-hmm.
they. You said it yourself. The first four Batman movies, we have three different guys and we have two different filmmakers. And even from the first movie to second, Batman and Batman Returns, they're wildly different in look and
action oh, yeah.
and tone.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I love Batman, love Batman, loathe Batman Returns.
It's right. And I heard you talk about that last week. You guys referenced that. And I think that, I don't need to see the same director make all these movies. I don't need to mm-hmm. see one guy helm the whole thing. I don't need to see one man or woman. What I need is for one person to actually be in the driver's seat. Or two people who have a unique vision, a united vision in the driver's seat and say, okay, this is what the plan is. And we're not going to give this thing. We're not going to give the keys to the car to a guy who loves making visual masterpiece, loves a visual storytell, but can't tell a cohesive story it's all visual. There's nothing substantive to it. And this is a guy also, remember, who has been quoted as saying that it would be much more interesting to him if Batman were raped in prison. Yeah. Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, we had a big discussion about that. And, let's leave it there because that's a great way to end it because we've all said, all three of us here from Batman on Film and Justin as well, who's not here. We're discussing this. We get criticized. You're beating a dead horse. You're beating a dead horse. No, this is how I started Batman on Film all these years ago, almost 19 years ago, is because I wanted good Batman films. And now we want good Batman films and good DC films. And we're not going to cheerlead for these films. We're not going to sing their praises when there are no praises to sing. And we're going to keep pointing out things like directors leaving and it not looking good and what the hell's going on. You know, asking what the hell's going on and having you on, Neil, to discuss that, because that is the goal, is not to criticize and just beat a dead horse. It's to maybe have some small little bit of influence, or just get the word out that fans do demand good films.
Well, and you know what? I want to build on that for just a moment. And that's just it. And I get tired. And look, we put our opinions out there. I do so from a comic book cinematic standpoint. I do so from a political standpoint. And quite frankly, the former is actually more contentious. I get my ass kicked more about my views on Zack Snyder than I do about Donald Trump. But I digress. One of the things I want to point out about Neil, to everybody that's listening, I'm going to beat you guys to the punch that he's probably a Marvel fanboy and this is just BS. Not only did he defend that, talking about his favorite comic book character, but if you go back the very beginning of this podcast, he listed his top three favorite comic books that are sort of the beacon.
The holy grail of graphic novels.
The holy grail. And they were all three DC.
And two were Batman.
Right?
And two were Batman.
Two were Batman. Yeah. So let's just remember that and put that in perspective, that this is not a bunch of haters. I think Neil is brilliant yet half crazy because of his Nolan trilogy opinions. But that doesn't mean anything. We're at the end of the day, we're all fans. We all want to see all this succeed. And just because we might have difference of opinion, whether it's about the Nolan trilogy or about what's going on in the new DCEU, there's no conspiracy here. We're not out to get you. We're not, you know, Neil's not an asshole because he doesn't like The Dark Knight Rises and I love it, right?
I'm an asshole for entirely different
reasons. Let's all get past that nonsense. If we can survive a Cheeto Nazi as our president, we can survive on DCEU, okay? And I just wanted to say that because that's important. And I want to say one more thing to Neil. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here. It's quite an honor. Secondly, I always try to get a Star Wars plug in on these, and sometimes I don't succeed. And you got one for me. All you had to do was reference the Han Solo prequel. And that's it. So thank you for that because you just did my work for me. Hope to talk to you again, man.
I want to kid if I can add one last thing.
Yeah. Now go ahead, please.
I would say that to build on what you both just said, I think that what people need to think about is it's okay. None of us like Batman versus Superman. I don't think any of us have ever said or are saying now that you're not allowed to like these movies. You can absolutely like Batman, Superman. Mm-hmm. It's all subjective. It's all a matter of taste. Yeah. And
we say that every week.
I think that you can like something or be a fan of something and still question the making of it, the process behind it. You can still make sure that the sausage is being made correctly. Mm-hmm. And I think that it behooves us as fans to ask more from the people doing it. I know that people can respond negatively to me that way, but I mean, when I write about this stuff and when you guys talk about this stuff, all we're doing is acting as fans to say, but we can do better. But it's not even that we deserve better. It's that, you know what? We expect better because we've been fans of this. These characters mean so much to us. And when they're not treated with respect, we are not treated with respect. And I think that's what we need to keep reminding ourselves, that, you know what? Just because it's a superhero movie doesn't mean it's not a great movie. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, a lot of people wanted The Dark Knight to be nominated for Best Picture, and it wasn't. You know what? It should have been. Mm-hmm. It should have been that year.
Yep.
It was one of the best films of that year. I think that there is still a stigma attached to superhero movies. Mm-hmm. And I think that as fans, we don't have to stand for that. And I think that that's really why I'm vocal about it. It sounds like that's why you guys are vocal about it. Anybody who reads my stuff and gets angry at me or agrees and listens to you guys and the same thing needs to take a step back and say, well, wait a second. Why do I care so much? Mm-hmm. And why take a look, take it from there. I mean, continue to hate if you want, hate on us, hate on whatever. But I think it goes deeper than that.
Much deeper than that.
Yeah, you said it well. Yeah, right? We're not telling you that you cannot like these films. And it's not a personal, attack when we criticize and so forth. So, all right.
Yeah, I don't want people to. Yeah, I was just going to say real quick. I don't want people to, because I kind of feel this in a lot of the comments I see. I think a lot of people are kind of internalizing it and feeling like, well, I need to defend BVS and I need to defend what's coming out because that's all we have, and I need to champion this. I have to force myself to like it, and don't do that. Just enjoy it for what it is if you do, but it's worth questioning.
I'm the guy that defends the Star Wars prequels. I know what it's like to get my ass kicked online.
and the thing is, you can read me three times a week at the tracking board. It's www.tracking-board.com. I'm out every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. You can read my stuff. If you want to tweet to me, it's at Neil Turitz, N-E-I-L-T-U-R-I-T-Z. Bring it. You know, I mean, write comments, send me tweets. If you want to get into a conversation about it, I'm happy to do it. If you want a name call, I'm not interested in that. But, you know, I think that there are legitimate conversations to be had about this stuff. And just because it's people wearing costumes and flying around and doing wonderful things doesn't mean it's not legitimate as a medium, as a source of entertainment, and as a genre. That's what I think.
Well said.
And as therapy.
And it's therapy. Yeah. Absolutely, it's therapy.
I'm burying myself in Batman-centric stuff between here and January 20th. Like, nobody's
Yeah, you know, I mean, that's why we watch this stuff. That's why, you know, I mean, 17th. Listen, my column on Monday is about what do we do now? What does Hollywood do now? Now that in the wake of this election, mm-hmm. and Hollywood is generally liberal in its bent, and the country has shifted, and, you know, all of us have our opinions about it. I'm not talking about politics because that's not my purview. I'm talking about what stories do we tell now? And I talk about the fact that after 9/11 was an enormous rise in superhero movies because that's what we needed.
Hmm. Yeah.
You know, the last
we needed it.
At the end of Spider-Man 2, yeah.
We needed it in World War II. We needed it in Vietnam. We needed it. Exactly. You're right. It's cathartic. It's therapy. And it's something that lifts us up from some of our most dire days. Neil, thank you so much, man.
Guys, this has been a pleasure. I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming on.
I can talk about the Dark Knight.
We're going to do that. We're going to do that soon. We'll do a Dark Knight trilogy podcast. All right, Neil, have a good one, man.
Thanks, guys. Take care.
Take care.
All right, man. That was a great conversation with Neil. I'm glad he came on, and make sure you find him on Twitter and read his stuff over at the tracking board. All right, Ryan, let's plug a few things. Let it rip, sir.
Oh, just follow me on Twitter at SMB_Ryan, and please leave us iTunes reviews because, man, I think we need some more opinions. I wanna read what you guys think about the show.
All right, cool, Rick.
So, Left Shoe Politics, the most recent podcast is up yesterday. GOP strategist, often seen on All In with Chris Hayes, Matt Makoviak joined us again to shed some light on the election, and it was a great discussion. And it's really a fun podcast because the first half is Matt kind of calming the nerves of three liberals and giving his brilliant insight. And then the second half is the Left Shoe guys, all three of us ripping each other's heads off. So, if I could edit it again, I'd probably get rid of some of the cuss words and everything, but it was very cathartic. It was healthy. We went at each other's throats. They thought I was crazy. And anyway, it's a good podcast. It's really sort of two podcasts that it should be two separate ones because it is kind of like this podcast is like, what's the film with Robert Rodriguez with the vampires and Tarantino?
Dust Till Dawn.
Great.
It's like that. Oh. It's like, you remember how that was like two movies, mm-hmm. right? It was, you know what I'm saying? Like about halfway through, it just seemed like a complete, that's what this podcast is, but please take a listen to it. Follow me at Shoe Rick, SHEW, and always please go over to the Batman on Film Shoes Facebook page and follow me there. I'm slowly trying to build that up.
So I will let announcer Rachel sing my praises. With that said, we'll catch you next time.
Thanks for listening to the Batman on Film podcast, a proud member and sponsor of the Batman Podcast Network, batmanpodcastnetwork.com. You can listen to the podcast via iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, Spreaker, and wherever good podcasts like this one can be found. Follow Jett on Twitter at Batman on Film and on the BOF Facebook fan page at facebook.com/jett.batmanonfilm. Email Jett via jett@batman-on-film.com. Follow Rick on Twitter at Shoe Rick and on Facebook at facebook.com/BOF Shoe. For Jett, Rick, the BOF Roundtable is Justin and Ryan. I'm announcer Rachel. Thank you and good night.